Well, hello there, it's Gloria McGlumford, and it's show number 50, and have we pulled it out of the bag for you? This is a scoop-a-doop, it's a scoop, 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 and we've got Simon Friend from The Levellers. Hello, Simon.
G-L-O-R-E-I-I-A-3, Gloria.
Oh, you're a charmer, that's cracking. I've got to notice that hairy coo, it's lovely.
It's Angus, this one. Sadie bought me that for the first Christmas we were here. I bought her another one. Same Christmas. We love it. We love it up here. And it's a cattleman's cottage we live in, so it seemed appropriate.
That sounds fabulous. And it's lovely. It's lovely. I love a hairy coo, as you will probably know. Well, I'm going to ease you in gently here. I like to probe a bit, so I'll get trucking. What is your earliest musical memory? What triggered you to make music or write songs or play instruments? I'll start deep.
Wow, yeah, that's an easy one, isn't it? Well, my mum and dad, bless them, they were big music fans, and I believe I'm right in saying they kind of courted Ronnie Scott's back in, well, the 50s, I guess, 60s, early 60s. They had a big love of jazz and classical music. They were very open-minded as well in terms of where you went with it. I could have heard anything, you know, to be honest, but my Leo Sayer was the first record I bought, okay? It's out. And I went to see him as an artist when I was about 11, I think, at the Derby Assembly Rooms. He's an amazing talent, you know. He had done a lot in his life. Bless him, he has his ups and downs and people love or hate him, I suppose. But I personally, I went to see him. I've seen him several times since. And great songs about sort of real stuff. And I think that was one of the biggest influences for me in terms of, you know, strange but true.
Strange. I mean, Scott's a bit of a fan of Leo as well. You've covered him, haven't you?
Yeah, I used to cover one man band quite a lot, you know, during right. My sets and stuff like that. It's a great song, but he is, like you say, a real talent.
Number one, Top of the Pops, when I was growing up, you know, and same sort of time, actually, as the track that we've just done. It was a very similar thing. You know, I was born in the Summer of Love, man. Well, the spring of the Summer of Love. And so my growing up was through the 70s when prog rock and stuff like that was happening.
Let's face it, it had cracking hair as well. You can't beat it. I mean, you are a multi-instrumentalist and I know you can play all sorts. Is there anything that you'd like to have a go at that you haven't played?
I've always wanted to play the Ealing pipes. I think it's like many instruments, it's that first step is very difficult to break through. As far as teachers go, you get good teachers, bad teachers. But I think the commitment that you have to yourself to want to do something is probably the biggest teacher in your life is yourself. Most of those instruments I taught myself, but I did have a good ground in trumpet, choir stuff when I was at school. But the Ealing pipes is like, it's one of those instruments I think that you play from the soul, like any bagpipe. I would love to be able to have a go, you know.
I mean, well, the thing is, there's something very soothing about the pipes as well. It's a lovely instrument. I wish I could play, but I don't have any teeth, so it kind of causes a bit of a problem there.
you need your teeth.
You need your gnashes if you want to blow. It's not great. You joined the Levellers like, way back in 1990 when I was just a wee lassie. You joined after the band formed, and how did that come about?
I suppose the easiest way was that they needed someone. I believe Alan left the band, and I sort of supported them. I loved them. I mean, I fell in with them myself and thought they were great. And they came and stayed, actually, the night in Nottingham when I was living out near Denby in Derbyshire. Gave a shout-out from the stage, going, we need somewhere to stay. Just one of those things that just sort of fell together, should have happened. You know, we all felt a kind of unity.
So did you have a similar outlook and ideology about life then?
Definitely. I mean, you know, in as much as the... You know, any group of people always has a slightly different outlook on certain things. You know, and the Levellers are no different. But as a bunch of people, we definitely agree on where we go and what we do. You know, there's no doubts really most of the time. It was one of those things that was magical. It was brilliant.
I know Scott's missus. I mean, if she was on, she'd be a bit tongue-tied, really, because I know that it was really one of the bands that she followed from being at college, and it was just somebody that played it in the car, and she heard it and thought, wow, it's just, it's cracking. I think it was one of the first 12-inch albums that she bought, but I'm not going about that too much because it sounds a strangle.
Listen, we love Amanda. She's great. She's good fun.
She's all right. She's okay. But really, I mean, talking about your ideology and your writing, I mean, you write from the heart, and it's all a very personal thing. But where does it start, that writing process?
It starts from the heart. I never predict it. It doesn't ever sort of, you know, it kind of happens for me. Like, for example, Sell Out, I wrote after watching Cry Freedom, the film about Steve Biko. So, you know, I watched that movie and, it made me angry, you know, and sad and everything inside. And for me, sometimes the only way of getting that out is to pick up an instrument and bang and shout about. I think The Shame was another one like that. I was absolutely incensed by what I was seeing on TV. I think sometimes, certainly sort of writers that we are as a band, it's passion, it's about caring, and it's about being able to tie in some of your own emotions and experiences. And sometimes there's a hidden message, you know. I talk about she and her a lot in my songs. Mainly that's to do with Mother Earth, Gaia, that sort of stuff. Because I love the planet and we mistreated her and disrespected her for so long.
The music itself, although it's very poignant and it puts across everything you've said, there's a sense of, there's a collective. You can do something about it. It brings it home, but it hopefully makes people want to do something and try and help each other.
Like most animals, humans are naturally drawn to each other, and we're not naturally aggressive. You know, when we're born, we're not born with fear. We're not born with aggression and hatred or any of those things. You know, those things are learned. And it's a sad world to see so much around, because it means that people are learning this in their lives as opposed to learning the true beauty of the world. So, yeah, you know, and I thank my parents for being so open-minded. Tolerance was what my mum preached. She said, tolerance, you've got to, you know, well, it wasn't alcoholic tolerance for this, like, unfortunately, the friend family was well known for our generosity with that. But when it comes to, you know, tolerance of people and human beings, I think it's all important. It's a lesson I think I learned from my mother.
You're now up in, well, it can't be avoided with the hairy coup. You're up in Scotland.
It's been very welcoming. I was at home one, well, I say at home, it was my dad's one year, and it was Christmas. There wasn't much snow. And I saw a bit of snow in the forecast for up here. And I said to Sadie, come on, let's go and visit a couple of mates in Ullapool, you know, and there's some snow due. And we came up and we've never gone back. It's a long way, but then in my line of business, I spent 30 years travelling the world. So, you know, to be honest, Scotland to Brighton, it's only 746 miles to the Medway or something like that. I'm sure the Dunicans would be more than welcome up here. They're a good crack, honestly, the people, and the music is fantastic. I mean, that is another thing that's always attracted me. West Coast music's very good. I love it. Music's accepted up here. It's very part of life. You know, people who say, oh, I don't play, turn up drunk one night and absolutely amaze you with what they can do. So you just, you know, and I feel actually kind of humble around here, you know, in terms of that, certainly with my bagpipe playing anyway.
It sounds beautiful. Well, this has been a cracker of an interview so far, but we're going to stop to get to the collaboration that's a bit hush-hush with Simon and Scott Dunican, and we'll be back with more scoops in a while. Enjoy.
We'll be right back. generals gathered in their masses, just like witches at black masses. Evil minds that plot destruction, sorcerer of death's construction. In the fields the bodies burning, as the war machine keeps turning. Death and hatred to mankind, poisoning their brainwashed minds. Darkness will stop turning. Ashes where the body's burning. No more war pigs have the power. Hand of God has struck the hour. Day of judgment, God is calling. Pigs crawling, begging mercy for their sins. Satan laughing spreads his wings.
again with a second scoop with our lovely guest, Mr. Simon Friend from The Levellers. Hopefully you enjoyed the collaboration with our Scott from earlier, and we'll get onto a bit more probing if you don't mind. Thank you very much. I was going to ask you what you most enjoyed about Highland life, but you've painted a fantastic picture, and I understand you've developed a few new skills. I know you're a bit of a chef, but are you handy with a chainsaw as well?
Strangely enough, I mean, I grew up in Derbyshire, and again, when we had snow, you know, big snow back in Derbyshire in the 70s, and I was always chopping wood. It was my sort of escape. I'd get the axe out and I'd be chopping wood and doing that from about the age of 8. I've always had this love of wood, and it's another thing that I want to do is to try and up my skills with the woodwork somehow. It will start with the shed. You know, I need to get myself a good shed together. I enjoy working with your hands as well. And I think, you know, living up here, it's just sort of, everybody's handy, you know, you've got to be able to fix something. But the chainsaw, as long as you keep it sharp, you know, same as your axe, keep the thing maintained, get it properly, you know. Back when I was a steel erector years ago, we used to use big diamond cutting, you know, diamond tipped edges for cutting big steel stuff, standing 14 stories up over London, you know. So I'm not that bothered about the thing, you know. It's a bit like an electric guitar. It's the same sort of thing. You're wielding this heavy instrument that can make an awful din if you get it wrong, you know. Anything you approach, now you're doing it the right way. It's like cooking, you know. If you perfect preparation prevents piss poor performance, you know. It's that whole attitude. Yeah, you get all the ingredients together, then you've got the right thing together to do it. Then there's, you know, there's not much missing. You know, sometimes it's a bit of determination, or the first cake's not going to work very well. You might burn it, but by the third or the fourth,
you're cooking on gas. And is there anything or anyone that you'd like to work with after this all sort of settles down a bit? Is there anybody you'd like to collaborate with that you've not also already done so?
Well, I don't know. Do you play any instruments, Gloria?
I'm not very handy, really, but you know. I can hold a note. I'm not kind of sure which note it is, but I can hold it.
I think Neil Young has always been one of those people for me. I mean, I've met him. We've supported him a couple of times. Absolutely starstruck, didn't know what to say. But he's a hero on many levels, not just on a sort of distortion level. It's very much his outlook, the way he looks and things like that, you know, the way he feels about things. And I just think somebody I would love to have maybe done a bit more work with in my life, you know, just if anybody music like that.
I just want to mention, you do bear a bit of a striking resemblance to somebody who was a bit of an honour in Dunican. Is it Dunican?
Oh, not McCoo Dunican. Dunican. I have a distant cousin of Duck Dunican, yeah. Yeah, I'm the Simon McCoonigan.
many a mickle makes a muckle there as well. I think that was it
was it. Yeah, they're wrong, they bother there, lassie. He's always been quite lucky like that, his old Duck, you know, as we used to know him as. Still knocking around Derbyshire somewhere, I think.
All that it leaves me to say is, thank you very much, Simon Friend, for being an absolute lovely, lovely person to chat to. You've been really, really open. Thank you very much to you, Simon.
Oh, bless you, Gloria. And, you know, Scott and, you know, Amanda and everybody behind the scenes there, you know.
She's hiding.
And down the old pint and puppet, because it's I have to come down there sometime. I'm looking forward to that.
Well, you're most welcome. But for now, it's bye-bye for me from now, Gloria McGlumford, and bye-bye from Simon.
Bye.
And yeah, it's... bye-bye, Angus. See you later, you hairico. And also, it's bye-bye to Scott, but he'll be back again. He always is. But show number 50, scoop-a-doop. See you later. Bye.
Yeah. Does anybody know what happens to love when peace turns into war? Does anybody know what happens to love when it can't be found at all? Can somebody tell me how the world could be so blind? Does anybody know what happens to love when love runs out of time? Well, I can still remember the last time that we fought. The lines were drawn and quartered in the calm before the storm. Can somebody tell me how the world could be so blind? Does anybody know what happens to love when love runs out of time? God goes when the bombs begin to fall. Does anybody care or even know? Or have you seen too much before? Can somebody tell me how the world could be so blind? Does anybody know what happens to love when love runs out of time? And when the fighting's over and you've evened up the score, you can't turn back the tables to the way it was before. Could somebody tell me why the world could be so blind? Does anybody know what happens to love when love runs out of time? Could somebody tell me how the world could be so cruel? Does anybody know what happens to love, or is love somebody's fool?
With another big neating new scoop. And if you think this is the Viennetta of all scoops, you're wrong. This is it's a triple scoop Italian and a Viennetta on top with a flick and some sprinkles. Today we've got Jeremy Cunningham from The Levellers. Hello, Jeremy.
Hello. Huge hands.
You're just showing off now, aren't you? Because you know I'm a bit hampered, but it's lovely to see you again. Nudge, nudge, wink, wink.
I remember our time in Glasgow.
How could I forget? Do you know, I've had my hair done specially, but I'm a bit all unnecessary at the moment, so I think we better crack on. Scott, you're going to have to take a back seat on this one, I'm afraid. You're the bassist in The Levellers, but you're also a band's resident fine artist. You create all the artworks for the album, singles, T-shirts, and more besides. You're a very busy fella. You're going to do an unusual but arty collaboration with Scott, but we'll get to that later. Now, me and Jeremy, as you know, Scott, go way back. I appreciate his fiery red hair, and in turn, it's an admiration for a lady with a certain azure blue hair, which, of course, mine's Iona blue, just like you'd find in the Book of Kells, isn't it? I've done my homework. Well, I'm going to ask you some probing questions, if you don't mind, so that the big, neated audience can find out a little bit more about you.
So I haven't been probed for a long time, so yeah, happy days.
I'll be gentle, I promise you. When were you first aware of your creative side? Because you are indeed a very creative chap. And who nurtured and encouraged this, if anyone?
Oh, my mum and dad, you know. I've still got reams of pictures I did when I was a kid. I've got it in the Metway, actually. Yeah, I was just looking at some the other day. You know, I've got pictures going back right till I was about 4 or 5. So, you know, I was always drawing, even before I could draw or anything. I was always, like, scribbling, you know, like Doctor Who and stuff like that, Daleks. I've got loads of Daleks and sharks, and I've always been interested in underwater stuff. So there's loads of submarines and sharks and stuff like that.
That's amazing. I know Scott's nephew is an absolutely loves Doctor Who, doesn't he, Scott?
He does indeed. In fact, to be honest, we've been trying to get him to draw something for something for this show tonight. We don't know whether he will or not because he only draws Doctor Who and that's it.
Well, Daleks are pretty easy, aren't they? I could manage a Dalek when I was like 5 or 6.
Well, has there ever been a preference between your visual art and your music? Do you like one better than the other, or do you like them both the same?
It's both the same, really. I mean, the thing is, you know, I had always thought I would be an artist. I never thought that music was just going to be a hobby. You know, I never thought I'd be lucky enough to, you know, to make a living out of it. And so it's quite ironic that I spent, you know, most of my life training to be an artist and then ended up being a musician, which I just kind of fell into.
Who were your early creative influences? Either art or music. I'll take either. I'm not fussy.
I could give you both. And I mean, the Clash was the big musical one. I saw the Clash when I was like about 14 on the telly on a kids' TV show. And they played Career Opportunities, like all dressed in black. And I just thought it was the coolest thing I'd ever seen or heard. And then afterwards, they did an interview, and Joe Strummer said, "Oh, anybody can do what we do." And I went, "I'm having a bit of that."
That's cracking. What about your artwork?
Artwork is, I'm really into history, you know, so it's like I like my pre-Renaissance painter, you know, like Book of Kells, like you mentioned earlier, with your nice blue Book of Kells hair. And I also really like American Abstract Expressionism, you know, from the 1950s. So when you kind of smash those two together, you kind of end up with what I do.
Well, it's got an absolute cracking style. And when you do a lot of the Levellers artwork, and that brings me swiftly on to my next question. I'm a real pro. When you're doing your artwork, when you're creating it, which comes first? Is it a song title? Is it the album title? Is it the artwork? How does it happen?
Or can be anything, really. Can be anything. Sometimes I've already done a picture and we start writing an album and I think that picture will work, or someone else in the band thinks that picture will work. Other times, like Mark or John or someone might come up to me and go, "We want this kind of looking for the cover," and I'll try and draw that. Other times I just think for myself, "Oh, this is what I'm going to do," and I do it and hope that everyone else likes it. So it's multiple different ways, really.
That's all about being creative, isn't it? And do you do all your artwork at the Metway? Because that's your studio, the Leveller studio, isn't it?
I do all the messy stuff there. I do all the messy, like, I can do, like, lino cutting at home if it's not too big. But, yeah, all the messy stuff and printing and everything all gets done there, because I am, as you can see with me, I'm just the worst at making a mess.
Well, as I was watching, I was fascinated with the art process, but I did want to do a bit of tidying. It's just me. I'm a terror.
I thought you might want to do a bit of tidying.
But the end product, oh, it's going to be an absolute cracker for people. I'm quite excited, really. But talking about your lino cuts, it'd be rude not to do a shameless plug for the uncredited Jeremy Cunningham, because Scott's an absolute terror, isn't it? So I've got this wing shot here.
Oh, yes.
We've also got this one as well, but I'll show the album.
Oh, yes. Yes.
She's an absolute beauty, isn't she? Do you have a preferred media in art? Do you like painting better, or do you like your lino cuts? Or does it just depend how you're feeling?
Just depends how one is feeling, really, doesn't it? I mean, painting is the hard one for me. That's the one you have to really kind of fight your inner demons, you know, which is why all mine come out looking absolutely psychotic. You know, because it's better out than in.
Looking at the process of what you went through, you just, you'll go over the top of things and just, you can't go wrong. It's just adjustments and how you feel and knowing when to stop, a bit like me, really.
Yeah, that is it. Yeah, it's just going over things and changing until you're finally done. And like you say, it's the knowing when to stop. That's the hard part. Because you can keep changing for your whole life, you know what I mean? It's so forgiving. It's such a forgiving medium if you're painting something. No, the hardest part is when you look at it and there's nothing there. That's the hardest part. And so You know, that's why I always advise people the first thing to do is just to destroy that empty space and just do something, anything, you know, make a few scribbles on it, and then it will start to appear.
I know Scott's missus was a teacher, and she had a lot of children doing the art lessons. The scary bit was, you're right, the blank paper, knowing where to start, knowing what to do, and just making that first mark and having the confidence to do it.
Yeah. Yes, it's all about confidence, really. Yeah, that's yeah. It's just that. Well, as soon as you've done a couple, you know you can roughly where to put things, and yeah, then it's just a matter of just doing it, really.
Well, you're working with acrylics tonight, and do you have a brand of acrylics?
I use the cheapest ones.
Let's come on to your collaboration with Scott, because he's sat there, aren't you, Scott? You're a bit. Oh, shall we have a little word from you, Scott? How are you?
To be honest, I'm enjoying it as much as I'm sure that the people that are watching this are enjoying it. So it's all good for me.
You're a bit of a fanboy, aren't you? Because I've met him before, you see. I've got over my fangirl status. Many a mickle makes a muckle. Let's come on to that collaboration then. Exactly what is it that you've done for us tonight?
Well, I've basically done a picture of you guys that Scott has asked me to do. And basically, I was going to paint my own picture. I've got a thing in my head which I'm going to paint on that wall or a wall at some point. But mine is absolutely mental and like dark, and like I didn't really want to go there, you know. So I thought, oh, it'd be much more fun painting you guys, much more colourful, and would cheer me up, because let's face it, none of us need bringing down anymore in this current climate. So I thought, yeah, I'd have a go at doing you guys. And then I've done a picture of the main cast. Actually, I say that. I did the main cast, but not Scott.
Oh, well, never mind that. I'm on it, aren't I? Don't give a diddle about him. He's on enough photos. He's a terror. I've been an artist. I'm like that Mona Lisa with the enigmatic smile, but less teeth.
He's like Venus with arms.
Well, you can't miss him, can you? Well, it's been an absolute privilege to see you working in your own art space, because, of course, we've had a sneak preview. We watched the whole caboodle. We binge-watched.
I get a chance to use a lot of, you know, really bright colours. And yeah, just basically get to slap a load of paint on quite a big wall and get rid of all my frustrations and tensions, like I usually do when I'm painting a picture or smashing a bit of a lino woodcut, you know, so... But as soon as I got about a third through, I knew roughly what was going to happen. I was just trying to remember all you guys' names, basically. That's the thing. And then as I was doing it, I was feeling that I was getting to know you all a little bit better, getting a little bit closer than I should have done. But it was fun.
Oh, I think we'll leave that one for a bit now. So I've gone a bit all hot and bothered. I think we're going to see you start the artwork in a moment, and then we're going to leave you to get on with things in your own pace and time. And Scott's done some technical wizardry, because that's what he does. He's done a bit of a cover of one of the Levellers' songs, Shameless. It's not called Shameless, by the way. He's going to do that over the time lapse later on the show. Thank you very much for the first half. I've been Gloria McGlumpher interviewing Jeremy Leveller.
See you later.
And Scott, well, we'll see you in a bit, won't we? Bye.
Hi, it's Jez. Some of you might know me as the bass player from the Levellers, but I am also the guy that does all their artwork. And it's a pleasure to be here on Scott Dunican's Big Knee Inn. I'm going to paint a picture for you. Here we are at the Levellers studio, which is where I also have my art room. This is the Metway in Brighton. And we're going in. I've also done artwork for Scott for the Bar Steward Sons of Val Dunican. I did The Devil Went Down to Barnsley and The Lady in Greggs. Although Scott put on the cover artwork by Scott Dunican, of course. It's just the way he is. Anyway, this is some of mine. Welcome to Metway. So, let's go in, paint you guys a picture of the Big Night In crew.
Hi everyone, this is Jez, bass player from the Levellers and also artist in residence. I'm going to do a little picture for Big Night In. The Big Neat In. So, let's start here. This is the Metway in Brighton, just Leveller's studio. This is my art room. In all its glory. This is where we'll do a little, oh look, there's the last Leveller's album cover there. And Sid. So this is where we'll do it. Not much space, it's kind of got smaller over the years. Oh look, there's my cat. Kind of got smaller over the years, so yeah, anyway, I thought I'd do a picture for Scott of his creations. And, you know, being his canvas is expensive and we're all skint at the minute because none of us can work, I'm going to paint it on the wall. So yeah, as you can see, here's the wall. I mean, I usually paint on big canvases like this. Here's one here. This is what I usually work on, but can't afford that today. There's a couple more stacked up over there. So we're going to do it straight on the wall. And our weapons of choice are acrylic paints, dry very quickly, and you can wash them off with water. Unlike these oil paints, which take a long time to dry and you need a lot of thinners and spirits and stuff. Okay, so let's get to it.
A second scoop of Jeremy Cunningham from the Levellers and his artwork that he's done for us. Oh, I'm hoping that you're enjoying what's going on so far, but I've got a few more questions. We'll get going if that's okay.
Let's do it.
Let's hit first gear. Yes. Well, no, I think I ought to get a bit faster than that, but we'll start slowly. Off we go. What have you been doing during lockdown? Because I know we've all been going slowly crazy here.
I've been going slowly crazy here. Yeah, it's like someone's put my life on pause, you know. I've been painting pictures, basically, and we're doing, I mean, I suppose I should talk about the Leveller's new app. I mean, that's what we've been doing, you know, because we can't play any gigs. We've been doing kind of lockdown sessions in our studio when we can, and we're just doing this whole load of other stuff on the app. You know, I'm doing painting videos and stuff like that. And yeah, there's all kinds of stuff that you've never seen us doing before, really, on there. And it's been fun, actually, because it's given us something to do as well as keep in touch with people. So, yeah, levellers.fan.direct if you want to go and get hold of it. It's a free app, you know, so, yeah, have a look what's going on.
We kind of did Big Neat In as a necessity of just trying to find something that we could do while do what we do. And I think, you know, there's a whole bunch of us as musicians that have, you know, that are in that group of people that are seen as unviable, which is a load of rubbish. But, you know, we...
I'm retrain.
you can't retrain this and we can't retrain you. That's not happening.
Well, also, you've done a project. You've done a comic book. What's that? What's that all about? Was it called Bass Behind Bars?
Oh yes, I do my comic. Yeah, for this Leveller's app thing as well. I do my monthly comic, which is like my. It's kind of started off as a lockdown diary because people were asking how I was because I don't do social media or anything like that. So, kind of folks were wondering, you know, how I was, and so I thought, well, you know, I draw a bit, so I'll just do this silly comic. And the comic has basically got sillier and sillier and more surreal as it's gone along. But yeah, it's quite fun.
It's a bit like us in that. Has it got Gus, your cat in it?
Gus, the cat, is the star of the show, yes.
Oh, that's foul.
Oh, my furry squid.
That's a lovely pet. I thought you called me that. I thought it was just me.
That's not two words you hear in the same sentence very often, is it?
No, I think I'll move away from that one for now. But also, you've done Is it right in saying you've done things like screen printing of T-shirts and you've raised money for the Levellers crew? Of course, as Scott's touched on, have not had the work during the, well, this situation.
Yeah, we've done all the crowdfunding. In fact, I'm just about to do another crowdfunder for people out of work in music for the stagehand. I've just done a print of the Carry Me single cover straight off the original lino for that, which, you know, I don't usually touch because it's so old. But I've managed to get a print off of that, and that's going to go into a raffle for out of work crew, basically. So I think it's 17th of February. That's coming up about that, because it's a fiver to get in, and it's a raffle basically. And then you might get the Carry Me cover.
I mean, that's such a good cause. That's amazing, and really that kind of links in with the whole Levellers ethos that you're all in it together. The community, and that's what we've tried to do a little bit of during Big Neatin, and it's just such a help. Have you had lots of reaction from your fans about it?
Yeah, I mean, they like what we're doing, you know, just to keep in touch, and you know, they're kind of getting to know us a bit more, you know, because we've usually kind of said, you know, it's all about the music with us, like it's not really about the personalities with the Levellers, you know, it's about what we do rather than who we are. But at the minute, we can't do what we do. So we're all being who we are. And so people are kind of getting to know us a bit better, and they're kind of liking that.
We talked a little bit about your collaboration with Scott, but who have you enjoyed collaborations with in the past, either musically or artistically or both, which is very difficult to say without teeth?
Scott's got to be at the top of the list, obviously. After that, probably Joe Strummer, because he was a massive hero of mine, of ours, you know. And he came and played on one of our songs, so that was really good. I'll tell you who else actually as well. We got to support Neil Young a few times, and that was really good meeting him. He was like a proper legend, you know. In fact, I've been really lucky with meeting my heroes. They've all turned out to be really nice, you know, thus far.
That's always a bonus, because it'd be terrible if they were a shocker, wasn't it?
Like Scott jumps through the screen and kicks my head in at the end of this interview.
I'd fight him. He wouldn't be allowed to. It'd be terror. You've been mentioning earlier about being a bit of a medieval buff, medieval history buff, that is. What are you reading or learning about at the minute? Have you got anything on the go?
What am I reading at the minute? I'll show you.
I'll get my readers on.
The Hibernensis.
Ooh.
100 pages of canon law from Ireland, circa 750 AD.
What is it about the history that rings your bell?
I don't know. I just got really fascinated by things I don't know about, you know. So, and I realised that I didn't know anything about kind of post-Roman Britain, you know, early Anglo-Saxon England and stuff like that. And I kind of started reading a lot of that, and then that led me on to Ireland. Yeah, I'm just that, you know, fascinated by it, because I just didn't get taught anything about it. And I don't know, I just fell into it deep. You know, I've been studying it for like 25 years now, and go to conferences and, yeah, all sorts, you know.
It's lovely to have an extra passion as well. And I suppose it's trying to find out more about the world around us. And, you know, we're only here for a while, and I don't want to get deep and dark now, but it's getting as much crammed into that time as possible and understanding everything.
Yeah, true. I mean, you know, the kind of people I meet through this history stuff, I mean, they're all so ridiculously clever, you know, speaking and, you know, reading, you know, multiple languages and being able to understand the original sources and stuff. It's just, yeah, some crazy, interesting people, you know.
My history knowledge is not, Scott's all right, but mine's not great. I mean, he did laugh at me the other week when I thought that Joan of Arc was married to Noah, so that's kind of my level there. After things get back to normal, if they do get some sort of normal, is there anything that the Levellers themselves have got in the pipeline? Have you got anything planned? And I know you'd had some tour dates postponed and your festival, Beautiful Days. Is there anything sort of on the back burner for that?
We're just trying to get, I mean, those dates, we've still got dates penciled in, but it just all depends if we can do them or not. So we're just kind of hoping and praying we can do it this year. But if we can't, it'll have to move till next year again. And tickets will still be valid, and as they will for all the dates we haven't been able to do so far. But, you know, we only have very loose plans at the minute because things are just changing all the time. it is what it is kind of thing, isn't it? It's just, yeah, we just got to deal with it. It, like I said, it's like, for me, it's like someone's just put my life on pause, and suddenly we've had a year and I just can't remember what I've done in that. I've done quite a lot in that year, but I can't remember any of it. It's just like a year has just disappeared, you know? It's crazy.
One of the things that I wanted to talk to you about towards the end of it was that we do have some very young fans that are new to art. And I think I'm going to get you, if I can, to introduce the gallery in a little bit, because we went all Tony Hart on your ass. And we thought, is there any tips that you've got for any of our young artists or not so young artists, actually?
Well, my only tip is just the same as art and music, is just to enjoy what you're doing. You know, if you're making art, just do the sort of art you want to do. If you're making music, do the sort of music you want to do, because, I mean, there's no guarantee with either that you're going to get anywhere with it. So you just got to enjoy it for yourself. And the thing is, if you do enjoy it for yourself, often that kind of rubs off on other people and you find that you do start getting somewhere with it just because of that. So it's this kind of self-fulfilling circle. So I would say, you know, yeah, just really enjoy what you're doing, believe in what you're doing, and yeah, go all out at it.
Just get stuck in. And I suppose that the other tip you had earlier was just getting something down on the paper or on the canvas and not being scared of it.
Exactly. Well, you know, for technical tips like that, yeah, just, yeah, start. That's the hardest thing, is to actually just start something. And, you know, when I'm rambling on, you know, when I'm doing that picture, if you're painting a picture, always start bigger, then get small. Don't just start finishing one bit and move on to the next bit, because, you know, you'll always have to change it. So always start big, get small, and it kind of paints itself that way.
Well, you know, you've been an absolute darling. It's lovely to have interviewed you, Jeremy. And I'm sorry we've not got much of Scott, but, you know, I don't give a jigger at the minute. But I need to ask you one final important question. Being very new to Big Neat Inn, do you happen to have a favourite puppet?
Well, how could it not be you? It's got to be you, hasn't it?
Oh, you said the right thing. That's great.
It's our former association.
I'm not going to say too much about that, but it's lovely. I'm an artist muse, and it's all amusing anyway. Well, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you very much, Jeremy, for being an absolute hoot.
Yeah, well, thank you. It's been great on the big Neat Inn. I think it's a great idea, and you know, I've watched quite a few of your shows now, so it's a pleasure to be involved.
Oh, thank you. The pleasure is all, well, it's all ours and Scott. Scott, have you got anything to say?
Thank you very much, mate. It's been a pleasure chatting with you. Even though I've been kind of sat here, it's been lovely listening to you as well. And thank you for everything you've done. I'm sure that the end product, whenever it kind of comes up on everybody's screens in a bit, I think people are going to be blown away by it, because we were. So thank you.
Thank you.
Well, it's good night from me, Gloria McGlumpher. And it's good night from Jeremy Cunningham.
Good night.
And it's good night from Scott. Oh, he's still here, aren't you?
Bye. All right.
Right. Start by doing a bit of a whitewashing.
What a beautiful day, the king of all time. Nothing is impossible in my all-powerful mind. It was on the 5th of November when time went back. Some say that that's impossible, but you and I, we never look back. And wasn't it incredible? So beautiful, and above all, just to see the fuse get lit this time, to light a real bonfire for all time. And what a beautiful day, hey, hey, I'm the king of all time. And nothing is impossible in my all-powerful mind. And said I love you, and Flint said make mine a double jack. Was then we planned the revolution to make things better for all time. And when Guevara said this crazy and ordered up a bottle of wine. And what a beautiful day, hey, hey, I'm the king of all time.
It's a beautiful day,
and nothing is impossible in my own powerful mind. And what a beautiful day, hey, hey, I'm the king of all time.
It's a beautiful day,
and nothing is impossible in my own powerful mind. In there on the big screen, every night I see the way all things could be for me. Temples down without a sound, but the generals, they were hiding at the ministers, well, they'd all gone to ground. Wealth redistribution became the new solution, so I got a paperback, but you got the one with all the holes. And what a beautiful day, hey, hey, I'm the king of all time.
Here we go. Here's the beautiful art room. Here's the beautiful picture. Scott Dunican's Big Neat Inn. Morris, the alien pub landlord. Gordon, glorious superhero nephew. Percy, the puppet wrangler. Do not mess with Percy, the beautiful Gloria herself. Gloria and I know each other from back in Glasgow. And Gervais, Scott's stylist, who has to put up with all that rock star bullshit. So that's it. There you go. It's the mural on the wall. My art room in sunny Brighton. In fact, let's turn the light off, see if it, under natural light it's a bit dark but you can get a better idea of it. Probably have to wait till it's a nice day, won't we? Yeah, there you go. That's for you, Scott and Amanda. I look forward to being on the show in person. Hey, getting to meet the guys, hey. Oh, look, my hair looks terrible. I've got paint all over it. There we go. Me and the Big Neat Inn guys. It was fun. I enjoyed it. So anyway, that little mural will stay there for a while until I do something over the top of it at some point. But yeah, it's quite cheery. Cheers me up when I come in. I might paint over the Scott Dunican there, just have a Big Neat in. No, I wouldn't do that to you, mate. I wouldn't do that to you. Right.
Say hello to Morris, bitches. I should have said, Morris just caught last orders. Much better. Hi, it's Jez. Jez from the Levellers again, back the Big Neat Inn mural. I'd just like to say, happy 50th show! Made it to 50. Here we go. So I changed it a little bit. Giving you a 50. And keeping it light. Keeping it light, man. Because that's what we want in these days of strife. So here's your beautiful mural. It's now 50, like your number of shows. I'd like to say like me, but I'm considerably more advanced in years than that. But happy 50th birthday, Scott and Amanda and Big Knee Inn. You're awesome. Levellers loves you. Cheers.